So in the previous video, we introduced the idea of the quantization of energy, right? And we talked about this from the perspective of these shells. So using the Bohr model of the atom, we said that we have the nucleus in the middle, the shell that's closest to the nucleus is called the first shell, and then we have the second shell, and we could keep on going. And we established this idea that electrons interacting with those shells are characterized by very specific energies. And since the first shell is the closest to the nucleus, then electrons in the first shell are at the lowest energy. So n equals 1, the first shell, is at the energy that's the most negative, the lowest energy. As we move up to the second shell, we're at a little bit higher energy, but it's still negative. It's just less negative, meaning that an electron in the second shell is not interacting with the nucleus as strongly as an electron in the first shell. Okay, and we kind of left it off there, and we use this to introduce an idea known as the quantization of energy. But as you might imagine, actually calculating these energy levels is pretty hard. So what actually is the energy of the first shell? Or what's the numerical value of the energy of the second shell? Or of the third shell? Right, and when we start dealing with atoms that have more than one charge, right, that have more than one electron, it starts getting really complicated. But when we're dealing with atoms that only have one electron, the math is pretty easy. So this model is only acceptable for one electron atoms. Right, so we could have a hydrogen atom. So hydrogen, you may know, has a single proton. Right, so in its neutral form, it's a hydrogen atom. We could be dealing with a helium atom, but it has to have a plus one charge, right? So a neutral helium has two electrons, but a helium with a plus one charge has lost an electron, so it only has one electron. We could be dealing with a lithium that has lost two electrons, right? So if we have plus two, then lithium has only one electron. So the only absolute requirement is that it has to be a single electron atom, okay? And the equation is the energy of the nth shell, the nth energy level, right? So n equals 1, n equals 2, n equals 3, is equal to minus 2.18 times 10 to the minus 18th joules divided by n squared times z squared. So n is the shell number, and z is the atomic number. Okay, so if we're dealing with a hydrogen atom, z equals 1, a helium plus 1 cation, z equals 2, a lithium plus 2 cation, z equals 3, right? So the energy of the nth level, of the first level or the second level, is going to be weighted by how many protons are in the nucleus. And that should make sense based on our understanding of Coulomb's law, right? So Q1, we've said a couple times, is the charge in the nucleus, the total number of protons. And the more protons they are, the more positive charge there's in the nucleus, so the more the electron will be attracted to it because it has a higher positive charge, a more attractive force. Okay, but so this is our really important equation. This will allow us to calculate the energy of any level for a single electron atom. So let's try this for hydrogen. Okay, so hydrogen has z equals 1, so this equation is going to simplify to the energy of the nth level is equal to minus 2.18 times 10 to the minus 18th joules divided by n squared. So for an n of 1, so for the first shell, the first energy level, our energy is just going to be minus 2.18 times 10 to the minus 18th divided by n squared, so divided by 1 because n is 1. So the energy is going to be minus 2.18 times 10 to the minus 18th joules. Let's try this for the second energy level. Okay, if n equals 2, then the energy of the second level is going to be equal to minus 2.18 times 10 to the minus 18th joules divided by 2 squared. And remember, we don't have to worry about z squared here because z equals 1, so it's times 1. And in this case, putting this value into your calculator, the energy is minus 5.45 times 10 to the minus 19th joules. What I'd like you to note is that when we compare these two values, right, here we have to the minus 18th for the first level, to the minus 19th for the second level. So the energy of the first level is more negative than the energy of the second level. And that has to be true because the first shell is closer to the nucleus. Let's try one more here. Let's try figuring out the energy of the third level. So the energy of the third level is equal to minus 2.18 times 10 to the minus 18th joules divided by 3 squared. Plugging this into your calculator, you'll see minus 2.42 times 10 to the minus 19th joules. Okay, so again, the energy of the third level is less negative than the energy of the second level. And that's because the third shell is further away from the nucleus than the second shell. Okay, and if you were to carry this out and do this for 15 energy levels, 15 shell numbers, what you'd see is that we start low and we have a fairly large gap between the first energy level and the second energy level. But these energies then start getting closer. So the fourth level is pretty close to the third level. The fifth level is really close to the fourth level. The fifth level is even closer and closer and closer. So what they do is they eventually condense on an energy of zero. So they make their way towards an energy of zero. And when this potential energy is equal to zero, there's absolutely no interaction between the electron and the nucleus. Okay, and mathematically, the only way to make this happen, right? So if we think about our equation, the only way to make this value zero is if n is infinity. Okay, so when the energy is equal to zero, n is infinity. So this is the infinite energy level. And practically, what this really means is that the electron is at an infinite distance away from the nucleus. And hopefully that makes sense, right? So if the electron is anywhere near a nucleus, it always feels an attraction. So to have absolutely no interaction between the nucleus and an electron, that electron needs to be an infinite distance away from the nucleus. And this is a tough concept to grasp, right? Because we know that electrons interact with the nucleus, right? But what this postulate is telling us, what this conclusion is telling us, is that every single electron is actually interacting with every single atom. And that's big, right? That's a pretty big conclusion. But mathematically, that's true.